Dear viewers, welcome again. We were talking about gynecological cancers as well as breast cancer with Dr. C. Hui T. Hello, Dr. So you were talking about vaccines in preventing cervical cancer. So can you please say anything else about the role of vaccines in prevention of cervical cancer?
Now, I think vaccines for many different countries is extremely expensive.
Okay.
In fact, the countries that really do need the vaccinations most of the time are unable to afford. We're talking about the, well, I think it's very difficult for me to name any specific countries.
Third world country.
In fact, there are now internationally, WHO is trying to lower the price of the vaccination so that it can be available to more people. However, vaccination does not replace pap smear and acetic direct visualization of the cervix. But the main thing is that the lady must see a doctor or see a nurse for a pap smear, because a pap smear is extremely inexpensive, even in very rural and very small hospitals. And a simple examination of the pap smear can actually protect ladies against any cervical cancer. And that just has to be done every single year, regularly for a few years. That can already reduce the risk of cervical cancer without spending a lot of expensive on expensive things.
Okay.
I think that's the main thing that we need to do, is to tell ladies that cervical cancer can be preventable, and the simplest thing to do is to go for regular pap smear.
Okay. Can you suggest any specific diet for a patient with breast carcinoma?
Yes.
Is a specific type of diet helpful, or this type of diet might harm getting a person of breast carcinoma?
Yes. Now, for breast cancer, as I mentioned, one of the main problems is obesity. So taking a low-fat diet and a calorie-controlled diet in a lifetime of a lady, from the time that they are 19 years old all the way up to when they have children, is very, very useful in reducing the risk of breast cancer. Even after the diagnosis and even after chemotherapy, we find that by having a calorie-controlled diet, meaning eating less rice, less carbohydrate, and also eating less fat, that can continue to reduce the risk of breast cancer coming back again. We find that the most problematic side effect of chemotherapy is weight gain rather than weight loss, because in this day and age now, when we give chemotherapy, we have got many good medications that can reduce the risk of nausea and vomiting. So patients always think, I must eat to have energy. So they end up eating too much and they put on weight, they get high blood pressure. So all these are the so-called complications and side effects of the chemotherapy.
Okay, what are the other complications that you experienced after different modalities of treatment in case of cancer patient?
Yes.
Post-treatment complications.
Yes. The post-treatment complications from surgery and radiotherapy is almost unseen, meaning we do not see any long-term side effects whatsoever.
Okay.
The main thing is why I stress so much on the diet is because doctors can give medication, we can do good radiotherapy, we can do good surgery, but we cannot tell the patients to stop eating.
Okay.
It's one of the most difficult things to do.
Okay, Dr. C. Hui T, thanks for coming here.
Thank you.
It was
for
a great pleasure
us.
Meeting you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in studio, Introduction for Us.
Thank you.
Dear viewers, hope you have learned many things about the cancers. That's all for today. Hope to see you on next episode. Till then, stay fine.
Can you please assist this patient? The moment we got the call, immediately went and visited the patient and provided all the information. And of course, I get in touch with the Singapore doctor here as well. Same day itself, we got the reply, okay, what can be done for this patient? So patient had to do a surgery. So Friday, we prepared everything. Saturday, patient flight. Sunday came in morning. And Monday, early morning, saw our oncologist and the surgeon, did the surgery. Now the patient is coming back for chemotherapy.
She was a young mother, just gave birth of a child. When she was actually breastfeeding her daughter, and she found that there is a nodule in her breast, and immediately after that, she was diagnosed with cancer. So we have sent a report to Singapore, to a couple of doctors, and the doctors were saying that if we do the mastectomy now, the baby might be, you know, deprived of getting mother's milk. But there's no way out. The patient came over to Singapore and was treated here in Gleneagles by Dr. Kuki Siong, and got back to her life, and the child is now 3 years old, and the mother and the child is both happy.
Many of the patients, first and foremost, may not speak fluent English, so they have a language barrier, and their local CanHope office, the regional CanHope office, is able to bridge that gap.
With patients coming from all over the world, CanHope has offices set up beyond Singapore to bridge geographical, cultural, and language borders. No matter where they are, our cancer patients know that they have a CanHope office to turn to for help and support.
And in addition to talking to the doctors, where the time may be constrained, they have another avenue of getting the information to clear the doubts.
The patient and us, is we are in the one team to fight with the cancer.
Because my work is only not work, but I do it with heart.
Even though you're going for a hard time, but this is not the end of the world. There is hope.
That's my hope.